Mamdouhan, Dr. Sherif, for my invitation to the ninth Pedia Dubai. Inshallah, today we will discuss a neonatal cholestasis summary about neonatal cholestasis, but we will focus on biliary atresia. Actually, this presentation, I think it is important topic for all pediatrician, neonatologist, pediatric gastroenterologist, pediatric hepatologist. And I hope you find some benefit from this presentation. This is our objectives today. We will discuss, we will enumerate the causes of neonatal cholestasis. We'll define neonatal cholestasis, enumerated differential diagnosis. We will discuss specifically today biliary atresia, and to know how to diagnose and management of biliary atresia. Actually, the time and the early proper diagnosis of biliary of neonatal cholestasis is very important, because the time factors play an important role in the prognosis of such cases. So early suspicion on both you all differential diagnosis in your mind when you're managing such a case is very important. Neonatal cholestasis, we define neonatal cholestasis physiologically as measurable decrease in bile flow. Pathologically, we define it as bile pigment in the hepatocyte and other features like bile duct proliferation, bile duct plugs in the hepatocyte. This is are essential to diagnose neonatal cholestasis. But clinically, accumulation of bile or any of its component, bile composed of many components, not bilirubin only. Bilirubin only is small trace of bile, but bile salt is a major component, phospholipid, cholesterol, and bilirubin. Accumulation of this substances in blood can lead to manifestation. If bilirubin accumulated, it will lead to jaundice. This is the component of bile, which mainly bile salt, phospholipid, cholesterol, and the bilirubin with other conjugate. And this scheme can explain to us how the mechanism of cholestasis. Actually, the hepatocyte has two membranes, sinusoidal membrane and the canalicular membrane. Blood came facing this sinusoidal membrane, then this component of bile enter the hepatocyte. From the canalicular membrane, this component will leave the hepatocyte. For example, bile composed of many components, as we mentioned before, for bile salt, it will be carried to the hepatocyte to NTCB and excreted according to many transporter protein. For example, LFIC1, LATBB11, this transmit bile acid. If mutation happen at this level, it will lead to FIC type 1, familial intrahepatic cholestasis type 1. Also, some of bile salt excreted by BSEB, bile salt export pump, if mutation occurred at this level, it will lead to familial intrahepatic cholestasis type 2. Bilirubin will be transmitted by MRB2, multi-resistance drug protein type 2. Mutation at this level will lead to Dobbin-Johnson syndrome. And we will discuss this point later. Patient may have cholestasis without jaundice, and other patient can also have jaundice without cholestasis, features of cholestasis. Phospholipid can be passed through canalicular membrane through MDR3 multi-drug resistant protein type 3. Mutation at this level will lead to familial intrahepatic cholestasis type 3. Cholesterol, this is cross a canalicular membrane according through two transporter, 50% each, ABCG5 and G8. Mutation at this level will lead to cholesterolemia. So cholestasis and hyperbilirubinemia are not synonymous. Frequently linked, but not unrelated. Sometimes the patient have cholestasis without jaundice, other patient, but few cases can have jaundice without cholestasis. We should be aware about the etiology of neonatal cholestasis. We should know differential diagnosis of neonatal cholestasis to know how to reach diagnosis or how to reach a proper diagnosis in a proper time. We will enumerate in neonatal cholestasis. First, neonatal hepatitis. Neonatal hepatitis may be viral, may be bacterial, may be parasitic, may be idiopathic. Viral, most common cause torsion. Torsion should be ruled out, the hepatitis B surface antigen, but please not request the hepatitis C in such cases. Bacterial, any sepsis can lead to neonatal cholestasis by also certain mechanisms. This endotoxin can lead to affection of some protein leading to cholestasis. Bacterial UTI is a common cause, but sepsis anywhere can lead to neonatal jaundice. Parasitic, for sure, one of the torch is a toxoplasma. Idiopathic causes, idiopathic hepatitis, previously it was the leading cause of neonatal cholestasis, but with awareness about the neonatal cholestasis, awareness about the differential diagnosis, about advancement of modalities for diagnosis, especially genetics, metabolic screening, this is not now the first cause of neonatal cholestasis. This other different and other causes for bile duct obstruction is one of the major causes of neonatal cholestasis, cholangiopathies. This include biliary atresia, cholecystocytic, non-syndromatic paucity, syndromatic paucity, bile duct stenosis, Caroli disease, bile duct perforation. All this can lead to cholestasis with bile duct obstruction. Others related also to bile duct obstruction, like an inspissated bile, like a cholestasis, like tumor masses, but tumor and the mass is not common in our age. It's common in adult. Cholestatic syndrome, some syndromes can lead to neonatal cholestasis. For example, familial intrahepatic cholestasis with different types, ARC, Nelson, cholestasis of North America, Algenes syndrome, all this is can lead to neonatal cholestasis. Metabolic disorders. Metabolic disorders, either carbohydrate disorders like galactosemia, like certain type of glycogenogestrogy, disease, not all type of glycogenogestrogy can present it early in neonate with neonatal cholestasis. Cystic fibrosis, protein metabolism disorders like tyrosinemia, which is common cause, and one of the major causes can lead to early neonatal liver failure, lipid storage disease, especially in Niemann-Pick type C. Other metabolic disorder like cystic fibrosis, like urea cycle defect, also certain type arginine only, not all types, not all forms of urea cycle can lead to neonatal cholestasis. Mitochondrial disease, bile duct sensitive defect, these all are metabolic diseases that lead to neonatal cholestasis. Also, toxic and drugs, which is important in our field, like TBN, ceftriaxone antibiotic, fetal alcohol syndrome. Miscellaneous causes, we cannot put in certain category, shock, histocytosis, some trisomy, graft versus host disease, veno-occlusive disease, erythropoiesis fetalis, all this can lead to neonatal cholestasis. As we mentioned before, the incidence, now biliary atresia, because of awareness, highlights, definition of prolonged neonatal jaundice, but for biliary atresia, to enhance the doctor to search, to investigate for biliary atresia. So awareness about how to diagnose the biliary atresia make it the first one in the etiologies of biliary atresia with development of genetic screening and also metabolic screening raise this to second and the third, and the idiopathic now is the fourth. But previously, it was the first on the top of the etiologies of biliary atresia. What's biliary atresia? Biliary atresia is a progressive, inflammatory, obliterative disease of the biliary system. Biliary atresia, the importance to know how to diagnose biliary atresia. Biliary atresia is the leading cause of liver transplantation in a child group. It also can lead to liver fibrosis, cirrhosis, portal hypertension, cirrhosis, and the manifestation of decompensated liver failure within a short period, considered in most serious 60 to 9 days, if not managed well. This is the most common form of cholestasis, as we know before. Biliary atresia can be classified according to the etiology into two forms: fetal or embryonic form or postnatal form. What is the difference between these two forms? Actually, histologically, there is no difference. There is no difference histologically. A difference only on the presentation. The embryonic or fetal type, this is constitute only 10 to 35% of all cases of biliary atresia. Cholestasis present since birth. So please, doctor who are following bilirubin in neonate, please request at least one time at direct. Didn't consider all the patient will be in direct hyperbilirubinemia. The bile duct remnant may be absent in such a patient. There is associated malformation for patient with congenital or embryonic type, but this congenital malformation is not present with the postnatal form. Kimura and Hayes classified the biliary atresia anatomically into three types. Type one, unfortunately, this type carries the best prognosis after a surgical correction, but actually this type, its incidence is very low, only 3 to 5%, some serious make it 5% of all cases of biliary atresia. This type, first type, carries the best prognosis after surgical correction, but the least incidence. Type two, which is obliteration, including a common bile duct, both hepatic, right and the left hepatic duct, this is constitute about 20%, and its prognosis is intermediate between type one and type three. Type three, unfortunately, this is the baddest prognosis among all cases of biliary atresia. Obliteration include extra and the intrahepatic biliary duct, but this is the most common type of biliary atresia. As we mentioned, the time factor is very important. So we need to hurry as we can to do early diagnosis. So suspicion of biliary atresia among a patient with neonatal cholestasis is very important. To know how to diagnose biliary atresia is very important. To send the patient to the surgeon in a proper time is a very important point. How to diagnose biliary atresia? Actually, diagnosis of biliary atresia is challenging, difficult in such cases. Why difficult? Because there is no confirmatory test to diagnose biliary atresia except the intraoperative plangiogram. No other confirmatory test. All tests are suggestive for biliary atresia. Stool color is very important to take, to notice in such a patient. Clay colored stool is one of the cardinal features of biliary atresia, but it can occur in other forms of cholestasis. Associated anomalies, this is like polysplenia, intra-abdominal vascular malformation, malrotation, levocardia. This is common with the embryonic type, not with the postnatal type. Clinically, the patient will present with jaundice, with clay stool, Growth is an important point. Actually, this point, patient with biliary atresia, their growth is usually normal at the start, but later with the development of liver fibrosis, liver cirrhosis, ascites, the growth of the patient will be affected, surely. Also, in addition to bleeding due to vitamin K, as all you know, that cholestasis will make the absorption of fat-soluble vitamin is poor. No single test can be beneficial for diagnosis of biliary atresia except the IOC. Abdominal ultrasound. Ultrasound is important tools for diagnosis of biliary atresia. This ultrasound should be done on fasting babies, not in feeding a baby, because feeding will lead to contraction of the gallbladder, which is, will mask the presence of biliary atresia. Also other features like a TC sign, subcapsular hepatic flow, all these ultrasonic features of biliary atresia. LIDAR scan, our hepatobiliary scintigraphy, this is the hepatoaminodiacetic acid test. This test can differentiate between neonatal hepatitis and biliary atresia. Neonatal hepatitis mean whatever the cause of cholestasis, metabolic infection, other causes rather than biliary atresia. Neonatal HIDA scan depend on the hepatic uptake of the dye and the hepatic excretion of the dye. Actually, in patient with biliary atresia, the excretion will be affected, but the hepatic uptake will be normal. To increase the sensitivity of and the specificity of this test, we give the patient elfenobarb 5 days before the HIDA scan. It will help to increase the test sensitivity. But we need to remember that the HIDA scan is sensitive test, but not confirmatory. Some centers are doing a bile stained tubal duodenal aspirate and do aspiration and test for conjugated bilirubin. If it can positive, this rule out biliary atresia, but not done in all centers. Liver biopsy. Liver biopsy is also a very important tool for diagnosis of biliary atresia. Accuracy 95% or more. But proper sample is very important. At least you need to take 5 to 7 portal tract to diagnose biliary atresia. This is one of the study we did it in our university to assess sensitivity and the specificity of liver biopsy in diagnosing biliary atresia. We find some features of histopathology carry more than 97% of the specificity and sensitivity, like a bile duct blood, like duct proliferation. This is came with biliary atresia more. Okay, now I finished already. This intraoperative cholangiogram management. This is Dr. Kasai, Morio Kasai, who did the first Kasai surgery. Factor affecting the prognosis of biliary atresia, the time of surgery, so proper diagnosis in early time is very important. Second, a remnant of bile ductules at the porta hepat at the time of surgery is very important. Early postoperative usage of steroid, some center compare it. Recurrent ascending cholangitis, one of the most serious complication can lead to failure of Kasai operation, and finally, surgeon experience. Liver transplantation If patient is not resolved after Kasai or entered on secondary biliary cirrhosis with other complication of portal hypertension, this patient should be for liver transplantation. But please, if you find the patient neglected biliary atresia, no need to send for Kasai. Send the patient directly for liver transplantation. Also, this study we did for patient who did liver transplantation, compared the patient biliary atresia who did Kasai with patient who didn't Kasai for result of liver transplantation. Actually, a time factor during the surgery, too much prolonged in patient with Kasai procedure due to the adhesion, due to the anatomical changement. But other patient who didn't do show less time of the surgery. Last message, our message today is only one message. Early accurate diagnosis is unimportant for successful treatment. Thank you. And I hope this COVID pandemic will end soonly to invite you to our first international scientific pediatric gastroenterology, hepatology, and nutrition conference, inshallah, in the next year. Thank you.